Distinguished guests, honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, respected conveners, co-conveners, members of the organizing committee, and all the delegates. I take this opportunity to welcome you all at the inaugural session of the National Seminar, Cashless Economy, Opportunities and Challenges, organized by the Department of Commerce, Aligarh Muslim University, in association with Institute of Chartered Accountants of Association of India. The purpose of the seminar is to unfold the myths and the realities and the prospective opportunities that lies beneath the radical move of the government to transform India into a digitally empowered society and a knowledge economy. To begin this event in sync with the ethos of Aligarh Muslim University, I would invite Bilal Asghar to recite the verses from Holy Quran.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم هل أتى على الإنسان حين من الدهر لم يكن شيئا مذكورا إنا خلقنا الإنسان من نطفة أمشاج نبتليه فجعلناه سميعا إما أتيناه السبيل إما شاكرا وإما كفورا صدق الله العظيم.
Well, no event is an outcome of a single-handed effort. There is always someone who takes the lead and initiates something. With great pleasure, I would invite the Dean Faculty of Commerce and the convener of the National Seminar, Professor Nawab Ali Khan, for this welcome address.
In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful, Honorable Lieutenant General Dinesh Shah Sahab, our beloved Vice Chancellor, respected Professor Prabhat Kumar Sahab, our honorable Chief Guest, CA Mukesh Singh Kushwaha, and Professor Prindam Gupta, Guest of Honors. My teachers, my teacher colleagues from various universities and colleges, members of electronic and print media. Last but not the least, my dear students, ladies and gentlemen, it's a matter of immense pleasure that Honorable Vice Chancellor, Aligarh Muslim University, Aligarh, has generously given us a chance to organize National Seminar on Cashless Economy, Opportunities and Challenges. I am really privileged to have the pleasant task of welcoming the distinguished gathering at the inaugural ceremony of the National Seminar on Cashless Economy. Ladies and gentlemen, we have today the unique honor of having an internationally renowned and nationally respected educationist, Professor Furqan Kumar Sahab, Secretary General of Association of Indian Universities. Professor Kumar has been the founder director of Center of Management Studies at Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. He has been the advisor, Education and Planning Commission, Vice Chancellor of Rajasthan University, and the founder Vice Chancellor of Central University of Himachal Pradesh. Professor Kumar has done his PhD on Financial Management in Indian Universities from Lucknow University. He has chaired and been the member of a large number of committees constituted by Ministry of Human Resource Development and University Grant Commission. The ladies and gentlemen, the list of his achievements is infinite. Sir, on behalf of Commerce and Management Fraternity of Aligarh Muslim University and on my own behalf, I welcome you at our seminar and thank you very much for spending your valuable time despite a hectic schedule. I wish to take this opportunity to welcome Professor Prindam Gupta, a very popular professor in accounting in India. I thank him. He is coming, he is on the way. I welcome him in absence here and thank him for taking pains by having a long journey by pain on a short notice. With equal sincere feelings, I welcome CA Mukesh Singh Kushwaha, the Chairman Committee for Capacity Building of Members in Practice. I am much obliged to you, sir, for your valuable time that you will spend with us. I welcome all the participants to travel far and near to share experience and engage with each other. Ladies and gentlemen, Digital India program of our Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji to transform India into a digitally empowered society and knowledge economy will be deliberated upon to witness its impact, implication and future of this transformation in our technical sessions. It is heartening to know the great interest of a large number of technicians, research scholars, both Dr. Fellows and different faculty members from different universities and different faculties. Even the UG and PG students and doctors find themselves involved to some extent in our seminar. Such a gathering is thus interdisciplinary in a way that is far beyond what we would normally even conceive. This will make the seminar a very special event. I am certain that you will find the experience of seminar here memorable. We are making every possible effort to make sure that this is the case. Once again, I welcome you all from the core of my heart in the Aligarh Muslim University. And because of the paucity of time, I will say thanks to you all. Thank you very much.
This event is presided by our Vice Chancellor, Lieutenant General Zamiruddin Shah. On behalf of the department and the organizing committee, I welcome you, sir, and thank you for making it possible to grace the event. I request Professor Sheba Hamid to please kindly come and felicitate our Vice Chancellor. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. I'm even delighted to introduce our chief guest for the event, Professor Purvang Kamar, who is the Secretary General of the Association of the Indian Universities, an eminent personality. Well, I request Professor Asir Chaudhry to kindly come up and felicitate our chief guest, Purvang sir. We are equally delighted and honored to have our esteemed guest of honor today. Professor Arindam Gupta, who is a professor of Vidyasagar University, West Bengal, will be here with us very shortly. We have another guest of honor with us, CA Mukesh Singh Kushwaha, who is working in the capacity of Chairman, Committee for the Capacity Building Members in Practice, that is CCBMP, of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. I request Professor Shamim sir from Department of Commerce, Aligarh Muslim University to facilitate him with a bouquet and a token of gesture. Thank you so much. The next dignitary on the dais is our chairman, Professor Mohammad Mohsin Khan, Department of Commerce, Aligarh Muslim University, who is also the co-patron of our national seminar. Thank you, sir, for being with us. We are very delighted to have you here and welcome you on behalf of the organizing committee. Next, we have on the dais the convener of the seminar, Professor Nawab Ali Khan, the Dean Faculty of Commerce, and CA Avan Kumar Singh, who is the chairman of the Central India Regional Council of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, Aligarh branch. I now request the panel to kindly inaugurate the souvenir of the seminar. We are highly solicited with the presence of our chief guest, Professor Pramant Kumar Sahib. I may now invite him on the dais for his address note. Professor Pramant Kumar Sahib.
Esteemed Lieutenant General Zabruddin Shah Sahib, Honorable Vice Chancellor of this prestigious university, Dean of the faculty, and all the distinguished members of the dais, members of the Commerce, Business and Management Fraternity, sitting here in this hall, all the participants of this seminar on such a timely theme, the students, faculty members, and I see many of my seniors sitting here. First of all, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Feel privileged and delighted to be here in your midst. It's always a pleasure to be in the midst of your home, and every time I visit here, I feel extremely happy. I think over the past 3 years, this is my third or fourth visit to the AMU, and every time I come here, I find the campus looking better and better. I am coming here after the announcement of the NIRF ranking. I know that many people are not happy with the 11th or 12th rank that the AMU got, but yes, it is in the top list of the university, and for which I would like to congratulate the Vice Chancellor, his team, all faculty members for this accomplishment. Although one need not read too much in any kind of ranking, and the best that I heard about ranking was from the Vice Chancellor of Sussex University. He said that initially in England, every university was very enthusiastic about rankings, but today there are 125 universities in the country, and every university claims to be in the top 10 in UK. So ranking has its own limitations. I think the essential objective is to keep on doing what we are supposed to do as an academics. These rankings, etc., are only a kind of symptom or some indicators. Since Vice Chancellor Sahib is extremely busy, he has to go for another meeting, so perhaps I'm supposed to be brief at the moment, so that he is able to speak before he goes. Maybe later on, if you permit, I can speak again. I congratulate you for organizing this seminar on such an important, critical, and also in a way controversial theme of cashless economy. But the idea of being cashless is nothing new. At least for the past 50 years, if not more, people have been toying with the idea of inventing new means of medium of exchange. As you all very well know, that money serves many purposes. Going by the old definition of the ego, money is what money does. And one of the functions of the money is medium of exchange. And cash serves that purpose. Medium of exchange is just one of the functions of money. Now this medium of exchange could be done in a variety of ways. And ever since we invented what we call money today, money has changed form. We all know. We have used all kinds of things to be used as money. So from leaves, the stones, metals, papers, plastics, to now people are talking about digital. As a researcher, I think our job is to go beyond the immediate political or economic reasons in which we are talking about this subject. And I think what we need to do is, we need to go into the depth of the issue and the challenges and the problems that are associated with various forms of money and their terms and their promises. Presently, in a country like India, non-cash related transactions do not account for more than 2% of the total transactions. The highest non-cash transaction economy is cited to be Singapore, where this number could be around 60%. Even in the most developed economies, non-cash transactions could be as high as 60%. So cash has continued to remain important instrument of the medium of exchange. Even much before we started talking about cashless or less cash economy in our country, people sitting here would know that there was something called as bitcoins, that was in fact digital coins, and there was a prediction that these digital coins would take over all other forms of currencies and coins. It had gained tremendous popularity till many governments across the world started saying that we will not provide the legal sanctity to bitcoins. And then the whole moment came down. It still exists, but people stopped talking as much about it. Now, when they're talking about transactions, and this transaction could vary from a very small amount of transactions to a very large amount of transactions. What we are finding is that with the possibility of money remaining in some accounts and with the digital technology available at our disposal, the transactions could be made by transferring money from one account to another. In fact, in most economies, bulk transactions have been taking place only through these electronic means. Not necessarily digital in the sense in which we are talking about, but they have been taking place electronically. For example, most of the export-import transactions, for example, what were the standard drawing rights those who are familiar with the exports, the standard drawing rights used to be a notional currency in which all countries had their accounts. The idea was to reduce the dominance of the dollar, or at that time the euro was not there but some kind of other currency from the European economies. And the idea was that why should we have dependence on the currency of one country? Why can't we have a denomination? So we worked this out, and transactions were taking place and values were being calculated of the exports and imports, and balance of trade and balance of payments were being settled in these formats. But as I said in the beginning, that cash is still occupies a very, very important position. Now, in the cash transactions, while there is some kind of an ease, there are also a lot of inconveniences. For example, people would say that even if you use credit cards, there is this inconvenience of taking out your wallet, taking out your card, swiping on a machine, and then money transferring. If you are actually using cash, withdrawing cash from your bank or from whatever source you get it, and then spending it. So they say that it is an inconvenient mode of transactions. And today, we are all talking about efficiency, and we say that the efficient transactions are those which cause least inconvenience to people. And if you all read the latest issue of the Forbes, there is a beautiful article, although it is about the perils of cashlessness, but one example that they are saying is that in Seattle, Amazon is making an experiment whereby all customers have an account and they just go from racks to racks and shelf to shelf, and they buy goods and walk out of the shop, and they are billed for the money transfers from their accounts to the store's account without their hands ever reaching their pockets or without giving anything into any digital machine, because they are all identified through their iris, through their faces, and whatever item they pick digitally, they are all captured. So they are all experimenting on these accounts, just to promote convenience to people. Now I think as a researcher, we need to go into many more details of to what extent this removal of inconvenience would be good for the economy. Because simultaneously, world over, there is another movement taking place which says that more efficient is actually being less efficient. In fact, if you do not work to get something, if you do not take trouble to get something, you actually are not able to enjoy what you have got. So that would in fact argue that perhaps there should be some kind of inconvenience which people should be aware of. There are also some other dangers associated. For example, the cash transactions have this issue of being incognito. Cash has no identification marks. Cash transactions do not identify individuals. And therefore, there could be tax evasion, there could be possibilities. So, there are a number of issues. I think the time coming to discuss them in detail. But at this moment, I will once again say that you have taken up a very important task, but go beyond the immediate political and economic politics of cash business. Once again, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. I now request very humbly to come on dais to our Vice Chancellor Lieutenant General Zamiruddin Shah sir for his presidential address.
Assalamu alaikum. Jai. Dr. Mohammed Kamal, chief guest, a friend of very long standing and whom I have always appreciated for his knowledge and for his tact and for his expertise. I'm Shri Mukesh Singh Kushwaha, Shri Aman Kumar Singh, Dean and Chairperson of Commerce. Ladies and gentlemen, my dear students, I have lived in times when the coding was legal tender. I do remember in Ajmer, the beggars were all given one kauri each, and over the end of the day they collected all the kauris and exchanged them for cash. One paise used to give 12 kauris. That was the value of a kauri. Times have really changed. Of course, the first beginnings of transactions was when the barter system came. That means you exchange goods for goods. And of course, this was found not a practical solution. I mean, if you had, say, leather and you wanted to exchange it, you wanted to buy clothing. So you have to look around. Who can mutually exchange that your leather for cloth? So it was a pretty inconvenient system, and then you have to carry. Suppose you have to exchange anything, a sack of potatoes. You have to carry the sack of potatoes. So efficiency came in with the introduction of cash. I really don't know how, but I would say several thousands of years ago, the cash system came and it did facilitate transactions, commercial transactions, and we got so used to it that when the time came for cashless economy, we were not really ready. And of course it will fall down our throats by the notebandi. But I think that woke us up to the fact that ultimately we have to adopt. We have to change. Just like the barter system gave way to cash, now we have to switch over to cashless economy. And I'm glad this very important aspect is being discussed by the Faculty and Department of Commerce. Of what is the effect of cashless economy, how is it going to impact business, how is it going to impact individuals, human beings. Having had the problem of carrying around bundles of cash, once I remember I had to buy air tickets. This was way back in 1982 or 83, where you had to pay cash at the All India, Air India counter, and my whole family was travelling. I would carry a huge bundle of cash because I didn't have the 100 rupee notes. I don't know what the 5 rupee notes were available. So everybody was quite surprised at the counter at me giving out. I think I had to pay about 7,000-8,000 rupees for 5 tickets from Delhi to Bombay. So I would say that the advantages are tremendous. There are of course disadvantages too. Disadvantages especially for people who have to pay for their wife's shopping, because they don't realize how much cash is going from the credit card. You know, you really don't know or can't anticipate what is going to cost you. So the as I see it, the advantages will certainly outweigh the disadvantages. And as for you all to deliberate, I'm glad you got some very, very fertile and active minds in the field of commerce here for participation, and I wish you all the very best. I have got an executive council meeting at 10 o'clock. In fact, I told the dean that I would only be available for 15 minutes, but I had to, pay respects to Professor Kabar, and that's why I held on. I'll beg your leave. I will beg leave from all of you, and I do not want anybody to accompany me. Please remain seated. I'll quietly slip away. Thank you very much. God bless you all.
Sir, please, the topic you started and the theme you started will remain incomplete if you don't find it concluded. So I will request you to please conclude your
speech. And we all know that how sensitive the executive council meeting could be, but despite that, he found time to be in our midst. So I do understand. Now, let's make a beginning. And how much time do we have now for? So now the point that I was making, and I think that making it more to young researcher. I mean, if our research could begin and end to where the journalistic writings had begun and end, it means that we are not doing any value addition to the subject. Journalistic and popular writings have their own importance. They capture any issues that they think are important at the moment. They do quick research, collect information, collect data. They present it for the popular reading. But what is our role as a researcher? Our role as a researcher is to go to the bottom of the issue that we are researching. And we need to find out the truth. We need to find out the reality. We need to find out and present before the world a theory which is true not only in the immediate context, but it's also true for at least some time to come. I'm very sure that when the papers are being presented here, many of you must have gone into the depth. Now, going back to this cashlessness or to having a cashless economy, I mean, we need not necessarily focus this from the point of view of the recent initiative taken in India. Of course, that is a trigger for our thought process. But then this is a universal problem. This is a problem across the globe and across the world. As I was saying, that using cash as a medium of exchange, and we know that cash is a latter-day invention. Ever since man started producing surplus, and they started exchanging goods and services, so there were other ways of doing this. Barter was one of them. But since then, we have traveled a long distance in the invention of various kinds of money. We also need to remember that cash is only one very small part of money. For example, if you calculate cash to GDP ratio, this cash to GDP ratio would be a very small fraction, ranging between 2 to 10%. But if you calculate the ratio between money and GDP, that ratio could be up to as high as about 10%. Now, cashlessness is a subject which deals only with this small proportion. notion of the cash, which essentially is the medium of exchange or which is used for transactions. As I said, the cash serves a psychological need. When you have cash in your pocket and that cash is a backing and is a legal tender, you somehow feel more assured that okay, you are safe and your transaction needs to be met immediately. This is the biggest convenience. But it also has many inconveniences to a private individual, for example, keeping track of money or carrying money, as the census I was mentioning. Is storing it in the cash form could always be a problem. Every textbook mentions about what kind of problem one faces when they store their wealth in cash form. But from the governmental point of view, there is an additional inconvenience, not as much to the individual, rather to as much to the nation or to the government. And that is that when the transaction takes place in the cash form, there is a kind of anonymity. Money in your pocket is yours, and by any means, if it comes to my pocket, it becomes mine. And unless you have been meticulous enough to have noted down the serial number of identity marks, you will never be able to prove that it is your money. But more important that is that there could be many transactions taking place whereby people who are interested in knowing that who has done these transactions will consider it inconvenient that they are not knowing. What economists would perhaps call it as tracking of the transaction becomes an impossibility. And therefore they might suggest that if transaction takes place in some such forms whereby they could track the identity of the people to ensure that these transactions are not illicit, these transactions are not illegal, these transactions have not evaded tax or have not avoided tax, then these people may have another reason to suggest that we should move to a cashless society or to a cashless economy. There could also be another kind of inconvenience which is caused not to the individuals but to another group of people in the society. For example, business people know, every marketing guy knows that when people take cash, they are somehow psychologically more careful in what price do they pay, what value for good they are getting. And therefore, people do not spend as much as is their total purchasing power. If you provide ease in transactions, people tend to use all their purchasing power, or people tend to go even beyond purchasing power. For example, those who are using cash only, they are likely to be less indebted than those who are using any other more convenient form of cash alternatives. It could be credit cards, it could be debit cards, it could be digital coins. So now there could be a vested interest of the business community, those who are into the business of marketing and selling their services, that somehow people should be encouraged more to spend, to buy. They could also advance argument that the economy grows by spending. We all grew up in a society where we were told that growth comes out of saving. Saving leads to wealth creation. But now, we are all being told that it is rogue is spending. Both may be right, but the business community has the vested interest that people is spending. There is also another institutions, and I think Professor Kushwaha and Professor Arindam is here. Now, banking institutions are more interested in people spending beyond their means. Because if people spend beyond their means, they are availing of their finance facilities. And if they are availing of the finance facilities, the banks are also able to multiply their credits many times or to the fullest limits, and that adds to the top line, which is revenue, and bottom line, which is the profit of the banking sector, banking or the financial sector. Now, as a researcher, what becomes our role? Our role is to see that if there are so many people talking about pros and cons of using cash or not using cash, going digital or remaining conservative, in which way the best interest of the society, best interest of the nations could be served. There could be two ways in which things could be approached. One, I mentioned the generalistic. Another extreme view could be the ideological, because there would be some people who might oppose or who might support based on their ideology. For example, all free market champions would in fact favor digital currencies, would in fact favor less use of cash. Those on the other hand would perhaps favor more cash. And then there are also, in between, people who may have the ideology of the privacy and the individual's right. And they might say that if everything is tracked, and they would give you argument that even now, when we are not using enough non-cash or digital transactions, we are in a way being tracked all the moments. I think all of those who use mobile, who use a smartphone, and all of us do it now, you must have noticed that the moment you approach an airport, you receive a message from the service provider that now the roaming is available. If you enter into the domestic terminal, you get one kind of message. If you enter into the international terminal, you get a message from the international roaming. It means somebody somewhere is knowing what we are doing, where we are going. The moment you enter into this pharmacy shop in the airport and you get out, you get at least 2-3 messages saying that you can buy medicines online. It means they knew whatever technology they use. In fact, going beyond digital, so we are already being tracked. So people would say that if you also track all of their economic activities, it will become a kind of surveillance economy. And then there would be individuals' right to privacy, which is so much guaranteed in all constitutions across the world, would be seriously compromised. Now, given all of these pros and cons, as a researcher, we have to go, as I said, to the bottom of the problems and to come up with a finding which provides more clarity on the subject. For example, one question that arises in the mind of people, that how come a small country like Singapore, the first example that I gave, which is so advanced in the smart city, in the digital technology, in the literacy of people, how come that only 60% of the transactions take place in non-cash form, in digital form? How come that people are still using 40% of the transactions through cash form? What has been the barrier to the economy like that of the Singapore? Second, if in a country like India, if only 2% of the transactions are taking place in the cash form, how much efforts and what kind of technologies and what kind of security in the technology would be needed to gain confidence to the people to reach to the limit of, say, United States of America, where 40% transactions are non-cash. So taking it from 2% to 40%. There could be some kind of coercive measure, for example, we saw one, that if people are compelled not to have cash in their pocket, either because of the limits on the withdrawal or because of the note bank, we saw usage of digital currency going up. But there are all indications available that the moment that was eased, people have returned back to, or they are returning back fast to using cash. So what is it? Now, is it that everybody who is using cash as a transaction, that's the third question, is doing so in order to avoid tax? For example, those salaried income group whose salaried income is all accounted for. On the top of it, they might not be earning more than 10% of their income. So they have no reasons to avoid tax because already their incomes are accounted for, known to tax authorities. Why do we all, belonging to salaried class, are still using cash? Even at places and establishments where non-cash mode of accepting payment are available, there are a number of psychological issues, there are a number of economic issues, there are a number of social issues that are involved into the cashless economy. In fact, if you go through the literature, you will find that there is a consensus across all communities of all nations that using cash is expensive. Going to non-cash methods, and I'm deliberately avoiding the term digital because digital is a very recent phenomenon. Going to any kind of non-cash, including plastic. Plastic is in fact also digital, so credit cards also digital. So we can say digital. So going to digital is the cheapest method, both for the government and also for individuals. For government it's cheapest because there is a possibility that all tax avoidance could be eliminated, or if not eliminated, could be reduced significantly. All illicit transactions could be banned, all counterfeiting possibilities could be banned. But most importantly, even a 1 rupee note, which you don't see often these days, has a printing cost 10 times of its value, if not more. And as you try to eliminate counterfeiting, you go on adding security features. And the more security features that you add in a currency note, the more expensive currency notes could be. So it is a very, very expensive proposition for the government. For the individual, I said, a lot of inconveniences. But then, there is something which is still compelling people not only the illiterate, not only less educated, not only in the underdeveloped economies, but across all worlds, to prefer somehow a cash. Now the world is moving towards non-cash or digital technology. This is also a reality. People had predicted some 50 years ago, including Alan Kaufman, the sociologist, that cash would disappear. In fact, they had given examples of the kind that where people would give alms to beggars by punching in the amount that they want to donate, and the beggar would be in a position to accept. Of course, at that time, people had laughed that rather than focusing on the elimination of beggary, you are talking about perpetuating this beggary through this digital non-cash methods. So people had predicted these things. 50 years ago, we did not have this kind of technology that is available today. 50 years ago, bank accounts were not even as common as they are today. 50 years ago, if you wanted to keep track of your own stored value, you needed to take trouble to travel to find out. But today's technology possibilities are enormous, that are telling us as to where your money is, how much you have got, and in real time you could also know what is happening to your money. So possibilities are enormous. Based on all of these things, most people have reached to the conclusion that future lies in this digital technology. And if here lies the future, then another and the most critical and the most critical question for researchers would be that what are the kind of guarantees, securities that we need to put in place to ensure that the digital revolution, digital cash, digital currency does not lead to unwarranted consequences. So we need to identify that what are the possible consequences and going into the details as to how to be overcome. For example, the one that I just mentioned, the identity and the tracking and the possibility of misuse. Second, I think the technology people would have to find solution that okay, even the cash could have been stolen. There have been instances where the cash from the ATMs have been stolen, and then there is also a possibility of your accounts being hacked and all the money that you had getting flying to some other accounts. So stealing was already there. The possibility of the stealing is not being eliminated. So what kind of technology, etc., that we need to put in place to restore confidence in the money? In fact, ever since we adopted fiat currency, and I'll just conclude with this, ever since we adopted fiat currency, and fiat currency is one that doesn't have a worth of its own. In fact, when you had gold coin, and when you had a gold coin, when its value was determined by the weight and the purity of the gold, you did not bother as much as to what will happen to the government. If the government was thrown, if the government was taken over by some other government, you could still melt the gold and get your money. Paper currency, plastic currency, currency in the accounts are what we call as fiat currency. They don't have any intrinsic value. Their value is only because people accept them as a currency. Or there is some kind of a sovereign bank guarantee before them. And it means this currency gains value only because of the confidence that people have in the currency. What do we need to do to keep this confidence in the currency? I have deliberately not spoken in the purely Indian context. Of course, some researchers will have to see the social, economic and cultural context of our country, because each society is unique and there could be research possibilities. So this is all what I wanted to convey at this point. Thank you very much.
Certainly the words coming from a person who is an institution in himself is a profound eminence. Thank you, Professor Kamma, for your words of inspiration. We truly appreciated yesterday at the event. Meanwhile, let me extend my greetings to C.A. Mukesh Bansal, who is the Secretary of the Central India Regional Council of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. Welcome you, sir, at this event. Since I mentioned that we have our guest of honor, Professor Arindam Gupta, I request Professor Hussain Ashraf sir to kindly come over and felicitate him. I request Professor Arindam Gupta to kindly address the audience.
Good morning to all of you. Honorable Vice Chancellor Aligarh Muslim University, in absentia, respected Professor Furqan Kamar, the Honorable Secretary General of AIOU, Professor Nawab Ali Khan, the Convener and Dean of the Faculty of Commerce of Aligarh Muslim University, the other dignitaries on the dais, Mr. Kushwa and Mr. Singh from Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, my long-time good friend, Professor Imamul Haq of Commerce Department, and other senior professors, faculty members, research scholars, delegates, and my dear students. The issue is such a debatable and thought-provoking issue that I first congratulate the organizer to take up an issue like this for discussion in an academic forum like this, because when discussions would take place here and there in the academic forum where persons from industry, from academics, from government would come together and discuss the pros and cons of introducing any innovative public policy, then much learning would take place and much confusion should be sorted out. And it's also my privilege, I must say, to share this with such distinguished guests, and especially to be present today morning in one of the most famous universities, not only of this country, but also of the world. So I feel really honored. And now, if I look into the subject, it was also my pleasure to listen before that Professor Kamar, who had so distinguishedly and very illustratively explained the issues, particularly with his vast experience of his practical exposure to look into the different aspects of cashless economy. And now it's my time to share some of my views, because much of the things he has already elaborated and much of the issues would be taken up by the paper presenters in the coming session. So let me start with the demonetization move that the government had taken before we had started to listen about shifting to the cashless economy. So this demonetization move was undertaken by the government all of a sudden, mainly to tackle three kinds of money, as we know: black money, fake money and terror money. To think about very simply, these three monies were to be arrested and tackled. So far as the facts and figures are concerned, these black money holders, they hold money in cash only to the tune of 6 to 7% of the total wealth of black money. Mainly they hold their black wealth in form of real estate and in different ornaments, goods like that. So another issue is this fake money, and it is clearly undefined because of the government machineries are everywhere. The law and order should have been maintained so that this kind of fake money could have been arrested. But as we know, this fake money and this terror money, they are again interlinked. And I don't have any clear idea, perhaps the government also doesn't have any clear idea about what exact percentage this fake money and terror money together could account for the total money in circulation. I don't think it would exceed the 6% or 7% limit that the black money holders hold in form of cash. So now if we take three monies together, this black money, terror money and fake money, it would not exceed 10% of the total money in circulation. So as a result of which, when the government took a very big and of course a bold step, whether it was rational or irrational, we cannot say that much clearly, but it was definitely a bold step to go for demonetization. One significant point that we all noticed, that common people of this country were clearly shaken, and there was an emergency-like situation in the country, a new kind of emergency. And we all were running after liquid money from one point to another. So what did we learn from this? What did the government also learn from this? Very clearly, some kind of control was necessary. Some kind of control upon the big currency notes were also necessary, because lots of transactions were taken place in 1,500 rupee currencies, as we commonly see in Hindi films when some exchanges take place in form of some untoward favor. Then that is all that is ever taking place in form of higher currencies. So normally the lower currencies, they exist in the hands of the common man. But then why did this crisis happen? And why the government went on introducing and printing so many 2000 rupees notes, which were even bigger currency? Why not other currencies were thought about? Why only 500, 1000 and 2000? Why not 400? Why not 800? Why not 600? Why not 200? If 10 rupees, 20 rupees notes are available, why not 200 rupees? But the government went on printing so many 2000 rupees notes that those were of no use. Even nowadays when we go to the ATM counters, we withdraw cash, we get 2000 rupees notes. But now we do not face that problem of currency exchange that we faced earlier. We only are having 2000 rupees notes from the currency, from the ATM counters or from the bank counters. The situation has improved definitely, but to some extent, I think if we consider the expense or cost aspect of this demonetization, then we may conclude that this kind of move was a bit redundant of the population problem, the wide education problem, the income problem, the remoteness and all these issues. But now, if something is to be introduced, you have to introduce sometime. And some problems people have to tolerate. Now, as a policy maker, the government has to see to what extent it is necessary. Personally, I am not in favor of a totally cashless economy. But again, let me add to this that too much dependence on cash and too much transactions in cash is also not healthy for any economy. There should be restrictions. So the government would go for imposing a ban or restriction on transaction above 10,000 rupees in cash on some selected issues. Maybe they can exempt the medical expenses or they can exempt some other areas for cash transactions, but in property transactions, may the government make that 100% should be in check or should be in digital mode, whatever it may be. In this case, I don't think anyone should have a problem. One who can follow the honest principles of citizenship, I don't think any problem. But if we go to the market, where the raw vegetable, fish, meat sellers are there, should I be able to transfer the money through mobile even after 25 years from now? If I buy at that time, maybe a cup of tea may cost 20 rupees after 20 years from now. So should I say that tea vendor that please open your mobile wallet, I would transfer the money through mobile only? Is it feasible? It is not feasible. So that is why a mixture of this cashlessness and cash dependent transactions is necessary. And there is undoubtedly a need to curb the cash transactions. Because you know our economic transactions, if we take into count the facts and figures, more than 80% of the transactions take place in cash. And think about the unorganized market, the unorganized economy that is totally dependent on cash transaction. So because of that, after this demonetization, the worst sufferer were those daily laborers. They did not get any assignment from their contractors because of not having the liquid cash. The government has already stepped ahead. Ratan Watan Committee has been already constituted. It has already submitted its recommendation in December 2016. But it has recommended phase-wise this cashless, to introduce this cashless economy in the country. And the government should learn from the experience of this demonetization. I was very surprised to see the helplessness of Reserve Bank of India, the government's main wing who looks after the currency, because there was no supply of adequate cash from Reserve Bank side. We learned from press and other sources that Reserve Bank does not have adequate capacity of printing sufficient quantity of notes. This is unbelievable. when you go for introducing any policy like this, then you don't have the things to supply, you introduce. So the government should be much cautious now. It is not for war, it is not for anything other thing you should be taken into account, but only for the people, only for the people of this country, you should think a bit, you should take opinions from different concerned parties before going ahead with this innovative move. What is my idea that you can do one thing, that this old generation, they are not even interested to go to ATMs. I have seen my father, my uncle, they were very reluctant to visit these ATM counters. So this is my own experience. So they are not in favor of this digital economy. So, and the poor common people, they are also not in favor of the digital economy. So this liking to this mobile phone of this younger generation, yes, you can encash it. But for that, you have to wait for one generation. And preparedness for cashless economy is welcome, but implementation of cashless economy should be cautious and should be introduced with much thinking, with much academic and practical exercise beforehand. So with this, I think I should end up. I again thank the organizers for inviting me to share my opinion, and I thank all those present in front for a patient hearing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Gupta. I now call upon our esteemed guest of honor, CA Mukesh Singh Kushwaha of the Dais, to please say a few words.
Honorable Vice Chancellor of AMU in his absence here, Lieutenant General Samiruddin Sir, Guest of Honor, Pukhra Kumar Singh, Chief Guest, Pukhra Kumar Singh, Guest of Honor, Professor Anuradhan Gupta, Convener of this National Conference, Nawabali Khansar, Sri Aman Singh, my friend in the Regional Council, Secretary of the Central India Regional Council, Mukesh Bansal, eminent faculties, my respected member of the Aligarh branch of Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, dear scholar, very good morning to all of you. I am listening to the view of the Chief Guest and the Guest of Honours, and the topic chosen by the convener of this national conference to India as a cashless economy. Yes, it is a very important subject for all of us, not only the scholar point of view, for every citizen of the country. They have to deeply analyze what is the intention behind the introduction of this scheme. Because I am also a student of the commerce, and also somewhere, because within a span of 50 days, the government of India issued 67 notifications on this. And I was the chairman of last year, Internal Audit Standard Board, need to guide my member, and immediately within a span of 10 to 15 days, come with this publication immediately after 31st March, yes, how to guide my chartered accountant to do the various activity related to audit of the especially bank transaction as concerned during the course of the demonetization period as concerned. All of a sudden, this is shocking news for every citizen. On 8th of November at 8 o'clock in the night, yes, your all currency of rupees 500,000 are no legal tender. But friends, the policy they have adopted Because these, the policymaker of the country, they are the ruler of this country, and they, it is their duty to govern and take care every city of the country in a good and effective manner. How this thing can be done? The government has the only source of income, the collection of tax. They collect tax from the various sources. It may be the direct tax, it may be the indirect tax. And in the indirect tax also different taxes are there. And this time, by introducing the new concept of the taxes and GST, 17 different kind of tax come together, and this new system of collecting the tax system and making this policy and regulating in the administration good, effective, good, we can say good for the good governance, they introduce the concept of GST. All things are cashless, economy is related. And for the student part of it, I like to say, yes, this is the era of knowledge. Because in the commerce stream is concerned, within a span of last 3 years, lot of changes are there. We have seen the changes in the companies, entire companies that have changed. We have seen the introduction of the income tax computation standard or ICDS recently they have introduced. They have introduced for the good accounting system, IFRS is concerned. Lot of things changes are in the, and without getting this knowledge, and now GSTs are with us, so we cannot work in the present scenario if we don't have the knowledge of all these laws and acts as concerned. Within a span of 50 days, we have 67 notifications related to challenge this scheme, because government is such, it shows yes, government may not be fully equipped or fully planned how this scheme can be introduced. That's the reason. Whatever challenges they face, immediately they correct it. That's the reason. If they plan in a large level, definitely the scheme may be failed. There may be possibility of the, they have the feeling like that, yes, if this scheme will be open to all or leaked out, information leaked out to the society, definitely purpose may not serve. And why this in a country like India, where we have a large population, only 2% we are dependent on the cashless transaction as concerned, and the category of the citizen whom this cashless transaction may affect need to analyze, need to research. Only 10% of the cities of the country it affect. What I feel, what Gupta ji told, yes, senior citizens, old people, they don't like, but how much money they require to spend? There are a lot of things, questions comes on the social media. I can, within a month or not more than, in a week, 24,000, we cannot withdraw more than the 24,000 rupees. But you, for the 24,000, you have to earn more than 92,000. Only then you can, if you have the income like this, then need to worry, yes, I cannot withdraw my money. You are earning more than near about 1 lakh rupees. Then need to worry, yes, I cannot withdraw my money. How I can use, what is my need is? More than 90% people need not require much cash, and there is no restriction at all. But how it will help the government? Huge expenditure beyond their capacity people are doing. From that, where that money is, are this money is the properly earned with the legal or legitimate sources, as well as that they have paid on the tax on that. If not, it is the damaging to the nation. To control huge cash transaction in the drug activities, smuggling activities, terrorist activity, to control all this thing. How much fund the government of India had to invest? Yes, making army stronger, making police network stronger, various business. If things are smooth or properly, then need not require these type of agencies also. That will also help to the country. And if 98% transaction on this good governance is concerned, lot of things are going to be electronic modes. Yes, where the public dealing interaction will come cut down, definitely good governance system will come. And it will help, because these are the various reasons which insist or initiative government, yes, they have to introduce the new technology. I was thinking, yes, everybody have this enough cash in their hand. Within the span of, we can say, after 31st March, today we are on the 29th April, within 29 days, there was a case for one not very high level authority, middle level officer, we can say, he was raided and more than 10 crore cash attached by the income tax department, 2 kg gold. How he can say ki this is my old, because all these are the new rate, notes, currency, and new currency recently introduced. Now it is very tough to there justify how this fund comes to him, how they access those currency. And not only the one person, many people have new currency also, enough currency, but government need to search, and the government is working on that. And this type of action definitely help to government to, yes, maybe by the compulsion, yes, we have to do cashless, divert to the cashless economy, and definitely it will help to the nation, it will help to the society. All things are actively related to the better facility to be provided to the cities of the country. This intention I think, yes, government maybe have. Maybe in the all process, some problem may arise. It is the means of bartering world. Previously, yes, I am not going through the history, yes, rightly elaborated by the Pukhran Sahib, yes, initially started with the Kodi, exchange of the Kodi, then come in the leather form as concerned, bartering of the goods as concerned. There is a various, but now in the future. And see, I would like to share one example, what research I had done. Friends, I was the last year chairman of the Career Counseling Committee. I introduced new concept. I give the option to the student of 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, giving exam by using their mobile or from their home. And I found in that research there were two level tests. One, online test. Second, physical test. And the physical test, on the basis of the result of the physical test, because there are a lot of questions come to me, okay, so you are conducting this exam and student will give their exam from their home. They will cheat, they will use the different mobile set, they will use the various electronic board. They can search out the answer of the question. But what I found at end of the day, when I analyze the physical examination result and compare best performer in the physical examination result as concerned, what were the result marks they have obtained in the online test system? Not more than 5 to 7% variations were there. On this basis, I talked to my colleagues, yes, their children also appeared in the exam, and some of my student staff people, their children also appeared in the exam. They say, sir, my children is given exam and from home. But as per the honestly, the entire system, what is the exam hall in the classroom is concerned. What I would like to communicate to you, my youth is very honest. I have given both the option. You appear in this exam from your home also, they can open the book, they can take the help of their parents, teacher. But it was not there. It is our duty in which direction we have to move them. So this cashless economy also, yes, need to propagate, guide and convince in right manner, yes, what is the benefit of this economy. There may be some hurdles, but because of our all efforts, it will achieve the object, and definitely all this impact of this cashless economy help the citizen of the country. Friends, in the end, not taking too much of time, I would like to end my speech with few lines. You might be remember in our freedom days, after 3 years, this university is going to celebrate their 100-year celebration century. It was established way back 1920, if not wrong. And this college was established somewhere 1870. So this is the history of this university, of this, yes. How this university big, it is my first visit and very big campus is there. Huge land was there. But are this the need of our 97 years before? But it is the thought process of that time. At that time, their leaders, yes, they have think, yes, this type of requirement for the next 100 years, and you have enough space to construct needful offices, classroom, hostels, and they have think 100 years before. This is the vision of the leaders, and you are the scholars, yes, it is also your duty to think about, yes, how we can help or contribute to the country, or by guiding in the right manner about the cashless economy. I have seen, yes, various literature, small research publication in the souvenir as concerned. I appreciate their efforts, all the scholars who has contributed to this souvenir. I was on the closing of this, yes, at the time of our freedom. To whom he says, yes, you are the kalam ka sipahi. Hamare jo patrakar bandhu hote the, jo hamare poet, कथाकार होते थे, उन्हीं को हम कलम का सफाई कहते थे, बट आज मैं जो हमारे प्रोफेसर हैं, स्कॉलर्स हैं, मेरे सीए बंधु हैं, उन्हीं को मैं कलम, क्योंकि उनकी कलम में वो ताकत है जो समाज को मोटिवेट कर सकते हैं, जागरूक कर सकते हैं, एक नई दिशा दिखा सकते हैं। तो किसी ने खूब लिखा है कि वो जमीन लूट लेंगे, आसमान लूट लेंगे, कली हर गुलिस्ता लूट लेंगे, कलम का सिपाही अगर सो गया तो वतन के रहनुमा वतन लूट लेंगे। फ्रेंड, इट इज अवर ड्यूटी टू अवेक द सोसाइटी एंड कंट्रीब्यूट इन पॉजिटिव मैनर टू द नेशन एंड द सोसाइटी। थैंक यू वेरी मच टू ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर प्रेजेंटिंग, एंड आई थैंक टू नवाब अली खान साहब, कन्वीनर ऑफ दिस कॉन्फ्रेंस, श्री अवन सिंह जी, हु इज चेयरमैन ऑफ द अलीगढ़ ब्रांच, ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस ब्यूटिफुल कॉन्फ्रेंस। थैंक यू।
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. I now invite our convener of the seminar, CA Aman Kumar Singh, sir, for his vote of thanks.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, Lieutenant General, retired Jamaluddin Shah, Chief Guest, Professor Furqan Khan sir, Guest of Honor Professor Arindam Gupta ji, CA Mukesh Singh Kushwaha ji, Central Council Member and Chairman, Committee for Capacity Building of Members in Practice. Friends, it is a privilege and a great joy for me to extend a vote of thanks to all those who have contributed in one way or other way to make this seminar a success. It is a privilege. The seminar was organized to initiate a dialogue on the theme and to critically analyze the contribution of the government policies, legal framework, technology and other initiatives by industrialists, academicians, research scholars, students and others with a view to bring climate justice and the challenge in the cashless era. Our guest of honor, Professor Arindam Gupta and CA Lokesh Kushwaha, have given a brief summary about the different aspects and challenges that has to be faced in the cashless era. Our chief guest, Professor Furqan Kamal sir, also shared his views elaborately on the theme and given advice and talked about the benefits advantages, merits and demerits about the cashless transactions. Presidential remarks were very humble to the Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir. In few words, he made a remark how people getting motivated with cashless era. Inaugural session touched the summit with the gratitude. The valedictory function was graced with the presence of various eminent personalities presided by pro vice chancellor of AMU in the evening in this hall also. Friends, CM Mukesh Singh Kushwaha, Chairman Committee for Capacity Building of Members and Practice Central Council Member of ICAI, Convener, Faculty of Commerce Professor Nawab Ali Khan, my colleague, and Secretary CCBMP Dr. Sambit Kumar Mishra, he is also coming here, he is also the speaker, resource person for career counseling, which is going to be held after the end of this inaugural session. Have been the driving force for behind this whole process. I also wish to express my sincere thanks to all the council members, especially Mr. Mukesh Bansal, he is Secretary of the Central Council, Central India Regional Council coming from Ghaziabad, and all my regional councils for their support and extending time for coming here to attend the seminar. I convey thanks to all the distinguished participants here in the hall who have come from distant places to attend the seminar. This reflects their commitment to their profession and studies. I hope that this seminar will provide a platform to share knowledge and expertise and critical review of the issues leading to defined growth for our profession. I also acknowledge the contribution of all those who have presented papers in this workshop. My sincere thanks to the print media, electronic media for their presence and giving excellent coverage of this seminar. Now the most important, my special and hearty thanks to all the staff, especially Dr. Nayyar, my Dr. Seema Tarab, she is also NOC, Mr. Sheikh Abdullah, Mr. Imran Ahmed, and other consultant and staff for their support, dedication, teamwork, untiring efforts. They all work smiling shoulder to shoulder to make this seminar successful. I am also thankful to all my managing committee, especially Mr. Gaurav Basne, Secretary Rohit, my guru and convener of the CPE committee, Sri Rajiv Kumar Ji, and other all committee members of my organizing committee of this seminar. I also thank my elder brother, although he is not related to this profession, Dr. Sudarshan Tomar, he is MABS MS surgeon. He is also present in this seminar. I am also thankful. And also Professor Durgesh Nandini is also present here. वो ये basically यहीं से हैं और उन्होंने हमसे senior रही हैं. यहाँ इन्होंने इसी university से इसी PhD की थी. She is also present in this hall. I am also grateful to her. I also wish to thank the students who have attended the workshop and expressed your thought. What is decided here would have direct implication for your future and the interest and enthusiasm. You have shown indeed a great good sign for the future. Before concluding, friends, let me express our sincere gratitude and appreciation to the guest of honor and chief guest who have raised this occasion with their presence here today. Finally, let me put on record our tribute to the Honorable Vice Chancellor for his guidance and encouragement, and at the end, I once again thank all the dignitaries on the dais and distinguished assemblies in this auditorium for their august presence among us on this historic occasion. Thank you all of you very much.
Thank you, sir. With this, we come to an end of this inaugural session. Thank you.